Pardon me, good evening, or good afternoon, and whenever you're watching this, and welcome to another scintillating episode of Corner Conversations. I, of course, am Paul W. Marino, and my co-producer here is the one and only Roger Urban.
Hello, folks.
And I believe Roger is starting us off with a continuation of where he was last week.
Indeed. The book, or booklet, I should say, that I brought in is called Brick by Brick. It's a history of a New England mill town, i.e. North Adams, Massachusetts. I found this at the Berkshire Emporium, and I think I got the last copy, but it can be ordered if you would like to buy one of these. We left off, and we were going to be talking about immigration into North Adams, and we had gotten through a little bit of it, and where I'm going to start is with the immigration of the Welsh. Now, when you think of North Adams, we don't always think of people being Welsh that moved to North Adams. Well, in 1801, there was a young man, actually a boy, named Sanford Blackington, and he moved to North Adams with his family from Wales. He was the second of 10 children. And his dad was a farmer, and they settled on about 100 acres of land in Centerville. Now, I had no clue as to where Centerville was, but they tell me here that's where Massachusetts Avenue is. So there we are. Sanford began to learn the business of making woolen cloth in a mill near his home, and in 1821, when he was 24 years old, he formed a partnership with his two friends, and they built a 25 by 50 foot mill, not very big, that was two stories high. He bought some secondhand machines with what little money he had, and because their partners were young and ambitious, it was called the Boys' Factory. And I will leave it at that. After hearing about Blackington's mill, more Welsh immigrants came from Newton, Wales, which is where his parents were from. And by 1875, most of the workers were Welsh, along with English, Irish, and Scottish workers in this particular area. And the village known as Blackington, there was a meeting house, a post office, a train depot, a carriage shop, a drug store, and houses for the workers. And if I remember right, you said that the houses for the workers were owned by Mr. Blackington.
Yes.
And if you left his employ, you also left your home.
That's right.
He was not a congenial boss.
Well, but that was common.
Yeah.
With the early mills. Arnold Print owned a lot of rental houses. And for that matter, so did the Plunketts and Adams.
Mm-hmm.
When you drive down Route 8 and you pass the brick row houses, those were all built by mill owners.
Right. And that went all the way up to Commercial Street, where I used to live.
Mm-hmm.
And you lived at the top of there.
And by the way, Blackington also had its own police station.
Yep.
With a jail, and I believe its own Odd Fellows Hall.
Really? Were they Odd Fellows?
Oh, very odd.
But I thought it was interesting that the big wave of immigrants there were all from the from England and Scotland and Wales.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty interesting. He then built a mansion on Church Street in North Adams on the corner of Main and Church. So then we come to the Chinese, and this is a fascinating one.
Oh, yes.
In 1870, a train arrived in North Adams from California with 75 young Chinese men. They began work with Mr. Calvin Sampson, owner of the Sampson Shoe Factory. And he sent his manager to California to recruit these people. It's interesting. It says the men didn't leave the mill very often. They did go to Sunday school.
Actually, Sunday school came to them.
Well,
the Methodists, realizing that they were all heathens, being Buddhists, organized a community effort to send people into the mill to teach them to read and write English, and of course convert them to Christianity. And there were so many volunteers that it was literally one-on-one, and in many cases it was children teaching adults.
I want to talk about one particular Chinese individual, and I hope I pronounce his name correctly, Liu Gim Gong.
Yes, that's correct.
He stayed after his contract was up, and he had a Sunday school teacher named Fanny Burlingham.
No, Burlingame.
Yep, it's got an H in there, though. I didn't realize that. Okay, she taught him English and was also a botanist and mathematician, and it sort of became his mother figure. And his mother in China taught him a lot about plants.
And well, his parents in China were orange growers.
Uh-huh.
I'm
going to get to that.
So he learned a great deal of the business from them.
When the Burlingame family bought a house in Florida, Liu went with them to manage their orange groves. He developed a new orange, which I didn't know, that could withstand colder temperatures, because that is what plagues the orange growers in Florida, is cold temperatures.
Yeah.
Oranges don't grow well when it's cold. So if they have a frost or a freeze, they have fans and you name it to try to keep the trees warm. He developed a new orange that could withstand colder temperatures, and it was named the Liu Gim Gong orange. Try to find one in the store.
Well, the thing is, the modern Florida orange industry is based on the Liu Gim Gong orange, only now they call it the Valencia.
Right.
So if and when you buy a box of oranges from the Drury Band, and it's delivered in December, that's what you're getting. You're getting Valencias.
Okay. The next business that this booklet talks about is the Sprague Electric Company. We covered that pretty well in one of our previous shows, so I'm going to pass on that one. And then we come to a Wall Streeter Shoe Company. Now, I'm familiar with Wall Streeters. At one time, that was the epitome of shoes. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you bought Wall Streeter shoes, they were well made and they lasted. This began in 1912 with E.W. Streeter as president and James E. Wallace, treasurer and business manager, hence the name Wall Streeter. Let's see, he didn't believe in trying to produce more shoes and do it faster. He wanted to make a quality product, and they did. They really did. In 1938, Robert joined his father in the business and started out as an apprentice under his demanding father. He became a shoemaker and worked in production for 15 years. He had an appreciation for the well-made shoes, and he eventually took over the business after his dad died. One of the Wall Streeter Shoe Company buildings still stands, and I didn't know that, and it is across the street from McDonald's.
More diagonally across the
street. Well, that's across the street.
Yeah, it's across the street from the hardware store.
You are very picky.
Yeah, well, I'm a historian, and I do like to keep my facts straight.
Well, it is across the street, isn't it?
Diagonally across the street.
It doesn't say that we're straight across the street.
But it's directly across the street from Aubuchon.
But it doesn't say that here.
Well, she's wrong then.
No, she isn't. It's across the street.
Antipasto.
Then we come to the North Adams Library. In 1884, the library was first located in the Davenport block on Main Street. The North Adams Library Association, didn't know there was such a thing, donated its collection of 4,750 books to the new library. And then they moved in 1892 to the Richardson House. on the corner of North Church and East Main.
Yeah, where the Methodist, where the old Methodist church is now.
In 96, Stanford Blackington, or Sanford Blackington House was purchased by Houghton.
A.C. Houghton.
Yeah, the first mayor of North Adams, and was given to the city in memory of his brother, A.J. Houghton. It was a donation along with the condition that it be used for a public library, and then he later gave $10,000 to help with the cost of changing the house into a library. In 1884, in the spring, the town opened the library and voted $2,500 for maintenance of the building. I thought that was very interesting. But another factoid that I didn't know about came about in 2004. The library closed and it had a renovation and had a temporary library in the Willow Dell until the library was finished. And it became the first green, and I quote, library in Massachusetts, and opened in 2005. The library has solar panels to produce power on the roof of the new addition, and it also has a geothermal heating system in the basement. So they had to tap down to get to the geothermal there.
Now, when you mentioned the North Adams Library Association, that's because the original library was a private one. It was essentially a club. You paid your dues, and then you could check out books. But it wasn't until around the 1880s, actually 1892, that they decided to go public and made it a public library, which was when they moved into the Amasa Richardson Mansion.
That's what I said, 1892. Yes. Right. Then we get to the subject of schools. There were more schools in North Adams in 1896 than there are today. Many people didn't have transportation, had to walk to school. Well, too bad. I had to walk to school until I got to high school, and then we ran because I was in sports, and it was good conditioning to run down to the New Adams High School from Pearl Street, which is on the top of Commercial Street in Adams. It's a long ways. In the snow, up to your nose, back and forth.
Uphill both ways.
There were no school buses, obviously.
Yeah, a lot of those were one-room schoolhouses. A lot of those were one-room schoolhouses.
The schools were Drury Academy, which had 556 students, Minor Street School with 387, Houghton School, my grade school that I went to until we moved, with 248, Mark Hopkins School with 486, Johnson School with about 430, East Mountain School, I never heard of that one.
Yeah, that was one of those one-room school houses.
Yeah. Blackington School, Greylock School, and they had about 100 students each. And the first Greylock School was on State Road across the street from Price Chopper. Very interesting.
I noticed she doesn't mention the Vesey Street School.
It might have. I might have skipped over it. Let me double check my numbers here. It does not. Then we go back to Drury Academy, and Drury Academy became very crowded, and overcrowded, as a matter of fact. There are high school students, grade 10 through 13, in the building, as well as the grammar school and primary school students. Now, I don't know where they separated grammar school and primary school. I guess kindergarten and that.
And yeah, good question.
I have no idea.
That would require some research.
Yeah, which I'm not going to do, by the way. Let's see. We'll leave it at that. Then we get to an interesting one. This is North Adams became the ballooning center of the country by accident. A gas company in another city was unable to furnish the quality of gas needed to fly the balloons, and North Adams was able to supply it. In 1908, the largest number of balloon ascensions in the country was made here in that year. Now, they used flammable gas.
Oh, yes.
The balloons that you see today, and they're beautiful. We used to have them when I lived in Pennsylvania. There was a ballooning club, and they used hot air. But the hot air was powered by like a little
gas
gizmo that sent the air up into the balloon.
I helped launch one of those balloons.
Did you really? In 1908?
No, a hot air balloon. I was working for Oldcastle Theater, and the set designer was a student of someone who owned a hot air balloon, and most of the inflating of it was done with a big fan. And when there was enough air in it, then they turned on the burner, and within a minute, it was upright and ready to launch.
They used to have balloon races. And let's see, Natalie Forbes went up in a balloon called the Conqueror, and she was the first woman in this area to go up in a balloon. I thought that was kind of interesting.
Well, she didn't go up in the balloon itself. She was in a basket underneath it.
No, really?
Yeah.
I thought they would put her in the balloon.
Well,
if you're
going to
be that picky, you wait till you come up on your reading.
Well, you.
She went up in a balloon. You say you go up in an airplane, right?
Yes.
She went up in a balloon.
In the airplane. If you go up in a balloon, you're not in the balloon. You're in a basket underneath. So
that's
she
part
was the
of,
first woman to go up under a balloon.
That's part of the balloon, is it not?
No.
Yes, it is. It's attached to the balloon.
Yes, but...
Okay, enough about the balloons. Good Lord. Did you get up on the wrong side of the bed today? Did you go to bed? Do you sleep in a bed?
No,
or do you hang upside down?
No, I sleep in a recliner.
Jeez. Now we get to the military, and we're going to start with the Civil War. And there was a group of men, 75 to be exact, signed up to form the Greylock Guard and elected Elisha Smart as captain. They were prepared to enlist if the war broke out between the North and the South, and they camped on the site of Massmoka today. The town, led by Sylvander Johnson, raised money to buy guns and uniforms. And they were gray. So in honor of Mr. Johnson, they called themselves the Johnson Grays. Later on, in 1861, they became Company B, 10th Regiment, Massachusetts Volunteer Infantry. And they wore blue uniforms.
Well, an interesting thing about them is that, of course, the town bought their guns for them. And then they were ordered to send the guns to Boston for inspection. And when the guns got there, they were immediately given out to other soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
Which doesn't strike me as quite cricket.
Well, who knows? Then there was the 54th Mass Volunteer Infantry Regiment. Now, what's famous about the 54th, do you know?
They were the... the company that was formed here, it was the second company of soldiers that North Adams provided for the Civil War.
This was the first military unit consisting of black soldiers from the North.
Ooh.
That I didn't know. This was before the adoption of the Emancipation Proclamation in 1862.
Which didn't free any slaves at all.
None. Black men were not recruited in Massachusetts up until that time, and Mass was the first state to form a regiment. I thought that was very good.
Now, actually, I think I'm mistaken then, because the 54th, well, what does the 54th specifically have to do with North Adams?
They were recruited in North Adams.
Oh, because I know there was a second company that was recruited here, but I think the number is different.
The 10th Regiment was the Johnson Grays.
Yes.
This was the 54th Mass. It was a separate thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, there was a separate company that was expected to be as famous as the 10th Regiment.
If I'm not mistaken, they became more famous because I believe they fought in the Battle of Fort Donelson. And there is a movie about that. But anyhow, we digress. Then I get to the Civil War monument at the top of Main Street. And this represents a typical American soldier. American doesn't say Confederate or Union,
mm-hmm.
At parade rest. And parade rest means you have your weapon, but it is not in a position where it's able to be fired. It's usually the heel of it or the butt mm-hmm. is resting on the ground. This was presented to the town of North Adams by the Ladies Soldiers Aid Society and was given to the town in 1878, and it was sculpted by Charles Niles Pike. And that's all I know about that. Then it goes on to World War II. And I guess World War II didn't have much, or World War I didn't have much of an effect, but it's not in this book, so I won't get into
that. Oh, it had an effect, all right.
I won't go into it because it's not in this book.
Oh, well. Well, then I won't bother mentioning about how...
Of course you won't.
H.W. Clark's son, Herbert Brayton Clark, often wrote letters to members of the Baptist Church who were serving in the Army, giving them encouragement and letting them know what their families were up to here in North Adams and what was going on in the church.
Okay. Now we skipped World War I. It doesn't make much mention of it here. But they go to World War II, and they mention a gentleman by the name of Anthony Sacco, Sr., and his five brothers all served in World War II at the same time. Now, later on, they didn't allow them to serve together, and that was because of the incident involving a Navy ship, which went down with mm-hmm. five brothers. Anyhow, he served in England, and then he was a gunner on a B-17 and was shot down over France and was sent home after surviving 25 missions. Well, they must have rescued him at some point in time mm-hmm. for that to happen.
Yeah, I remember Tony. He was a really nice guy. Yeah.
And then there's Ralph, and he served in the Army Engineers, but he was killed in action in 45 in Germany. Then they talk about the War Memorial Tower, erected in 1933 at the top of Mount Greylock to honor all war veterans. And the light from the beacon, when it's turned on, supposedly can be seen 70 miles away. Now, the town is in the town of, the tower's in the town of Adams.
Yes, and that was actually built, well, it was designed to be a lighthouse.
Mm-hmm. And it looks like one when you see it. When I was a youngster, one of my neighbors, the same age as I am, used to brag that his mother contributed the first dime to help mm-hmm. build that tower. And he probably did. And I said, that's great, you know, wonderful.
And in the 1960s, they were talking about tearing it down and replacing it with a statue of a grieving woman. And what I recall seeing the photos, it was a really ugly sort of thing.
They should never.
Nowhere near as nice as the tower.
Should never tear that down. It's an icon of the area.
Yeah.
Then they talk about Mike DeMarco. I won't go into it much. We all know a lot about Michael. He was killed in action. Apparently was a very nice guy. In the 1st Battalion, 23rd Infantry Regiment, 3rd Stryker Brigade. Now, if you don't know what a Stryker is, it's an armored vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
Not a tank. That's wheels. And he was 20 years old when he perished. Then we get to a couple more people.
And I recognize a couple faces there.
I'm sure you do. One is John Dwight Happy Jack Cheesebro. He was born in North Adams in 1874, and he was a major league pitcher with the Boston Pilgrims, now the Boston Red Sox. He became a legend, and he won 41 games in one season, and his record still stands as of the printing of this book. Booklet, I should say.
And what was his claim to fame?
Struck out Babe Ruth.
No, he threw the wettest spitball in baseball.
Well...
It was legal that. At the time he was playing. Thank goodness it isn't anymore.
Mm-hmm. Now it goes on to mention George Lawrence.
George Pelton Lawrence.
Yes, he graduated from Jury Academy in 1876, was a lawyer and appointed judge in 1885.
And youngest judge in Massachusetts at the time. Youngest judge in Massachusetts at the time.
And then he served in the Massachusetts State Senate. Then we went to Frank Sprague. Now we discussed him early on with one of our previous shows.
Oh, now you also missed, or maybe she missed, that George Pelton Lawrence was also the first, and I think only, native of North Adams to be elected to national office. He served in the U.S. House of Representatives and arranged for the money to build the North Adams Post Office, which went from groundbreaking to grand opening in almost exactly 1 year. It was off by only a day.
And that's not in here either, so I'm glad you put that in. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any the other people in here are currently around, so I'm not going to bring that up.
But do tell about Frank.
About Frank?
Frank Sprague.
Okay, we already did that, but we'll do it again. He grew up in North Adams, graduated from Drury High School, went to the Naval Academy.
He did not graduate. He left in his junior year to attend Annapolis.
See, that's what you want. You want me to bring that up so you can argue with me. I didn't write this, you have to understand.
Yes, I understand.
I am just reading it. it's going to be one of those days, folks.
Yes, it is.
In 1883, he worked with Thomas Edison. I didn't know that. He invented a motor that was used in 90% of railway systems and became became technology used in subways today.
And when Sprague Specialties moved into the Marshall Street complex and it became Sprague Electric Company, they found two motors in there, electric motors, that had been manufactured by the Sprague Electric Works of New York City.
Really? Okay, some of the other people mentioned, and I'm not going to go into their bios because they're still here, and it's a good thing. Dan Bosley, he's at MCLA. Martha Coakley, she was elected Attorney General of the state of Massachusetts. Dr. Paul Farmer, he's an anthropologist and a doctor in anthropology, I assume. And he works to provide health care in foreign countries like Haiti and places like that. And also works at Brigham's Women's and Children's Hospital. Professor at Harvard University and special envoy to Haiti under Mr. Clinton, President Clinton for the rest of us.
Well, if he works at a hospital and he's instrumental in bringing health care, then I would guess he is a medical doctor as well.
Yes. Yeah. It says doctor, which is more than just a regular PhD. Okay. We talked about these folks. And we talked about that. And I shall go on to the Massachusetts College of Liberal Arts, which initially was called Normal School, the Massachusetts Normal School. In 1897, it began with four teachers and 32 students. In the beginning, it trained students to become teachers in the public schools and had only one building, Murdoch Hall. And I remember old Murdoch Hall. It's still there. In 2006, that was after my time there, the building was renovated and totally restored with the latest technology, and now there are more than 2,000 students attending MCLA.
Of course, it also underwent several name changes. It started out as North Adams Normal.
Right.
And in fact, when I was in third grade, at Johnson School, every member of the faculty, including the principal, were all graduates of that one institution.
How about that?
Of course, their alma maters were given under different names. The oldest were from North Adams Normal. And by the time I was there, it was North Adams State Teachers College.
Correct.
And then it eventually, and it had a couple names before that, which I don't remember off the top of my head, but then it became North Adams State College. And then finally, the president, who was supposed to maintain the name North Adams State College, changed it at the last minute without consulting anyone to Massachusetts College of Liberal Arts, which upset a lot of people in North Adams.
I imagine so.
Including a lot of students.
I imagine it did. Then they have the North Adams Museum of History and Science. Paul, would you like to elaborate on that?
It started out as the Museum of the North Adams Historical Society.
Correct.
And they got a new president who had worked for the Museum of Natural History in New York, came to North Adams with a .com, and he had a grand scheme of a historical museum with a science center. And rather than team up with one of the colleges, like Williams or MCLA, he organized it with the Historical Society. So they moved into a big three-story space with no stairs. Well, it has stairs, but no elevator, which of course was illegal. And it was very much quickly thrown together. I recall hearing, well, you just have to remember that museum was thrown together in only 2 months. Well, a lot of people went in there, wow, this is fabulous, but it could have been tons and tons better. I remember going into the Fort Massachusetts room, which was very nice, except the floor was way too neat to be Fort Massachusetts. And there was a drawing of a rifle that had been Xeroxed out of a book, enlarged, and then cut out and pasted on the wall. You know, and there were a number of things like that.
I went into it when it was down in the...
Yeah, it's now in the hotel.
No, this was before that. This was down at the railroad yard there. And I found it interesting. There were some things I enjoyed of it and some things I thought could have been better. I was also told that if I had gone upstairs, which no one was allowed to do, there are a lot of things I would be interested in, because a lot of military things up there. Well, that's nice to know. Now we have it in a hotel. I have not been there since they moved in there. I have not either. No disrespect to anybody, but it's a hell of a place to have a museum. And there were places open, and there still are.
Yeah.
It could be expanded a great deal, considering what buildings we have vacant. And the buildings are historic in nature anyway.
Yeah.
It's sad. It's sad. But...
Well, part of the problem is that the Historical Society today is not an active society. And what I mean by that is the board is making all the decisions. They do not have meetings of the society anymore because the board has so much to do. They have to run the store, they have to do all the exhibits, they have to do this and that and the other thing. If you were to join the society today, you would get two things. One, you would get the monthly newsletter, and B, you could volunteer in the museum, which is not that much of a deal.
It's my understanding that you can't volunteer to join. You have to
be asked. Oh, I hadn't heard that.
That's what I was told, because I was obviously interested in it.
Mm-hmm.
With the background that I have and my interest in history, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, I thought it would be great to do that. But here I am.
Yeah. As I was saying, if you're a member of the Historical Society, you cannot serve on a committee because there are no committees. You know, and one thing I learned before leaving the church was, in order for an organization to be healthy, you need everyone to be involved. So instead of having a small group of people or even a large group of people making all the decisions, you have committees. So you need a fundraising committee, you need an exhibits committee, you need a publicity committee. I used to be able to rattle off all the committees that you needed, and then you find people in the organization that are interested in being on those committees.
You may have a background in
Yeah, and can help make the decisions so that the board does not have to do every little thing. And that's the thing, the board is running absolutely everything.
And how does one get to be on a historical society?
Normally you just join.
You don't do that anymore.
Yeah.
You have to be invited to join. And I don't know how the hell that works. I don't know how the heck that works. Because I've had an interest in it in a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And nada.
Yeah, well, of course, I've also been told that they don't want me as president because I know too much.
Hello?
Yeah, I know too much about how to run an organization. I know too much about local history. What is it that I know too much of?
Probably know too much about other people.
Well, that
and
could
that
be.
And that could be part of it, you know? And that's what bugs me about some of the things that I've heard. Anyhow. To get back to this, the booklet is Brick by Brick, and I think if you purchase it, you'll find it a very interesting read. I haven't gone through all of it on the show, leaving some of it for
which
you.
Which is good, because you should just give a brief overview. Yeah.
And I think we've done pretty well with that one. But I'm very disappointed that so much of the history of North Adams is kept within such a small, tight circle
mm-hmm.
and isn't broadcast out to the residents of North Adams in some way, shape, or form. That bugs
well,
me.
Well, that's one reason why when I go into a store, I look for people with kids and I ask about the kids. How old are your kids? Because it's been my experience, 90% of them are delighted to talk about their kids. Oh, he's 5, she's 9, he's 12. And then I give them one of my cards and I tell them, take these kids to my website, to the page Great Moments in Local History, where there's enough local history to bore the whole family to tears. And most parents are delighted. Oh, good, he likes history. Oh, she loves history. I love history.
Sad.
Yeah. Yeah, and so I am spreading the word, you know, bit by bit.
I mean, I don't know. I don't want to get into it because I don't want to get involved in the politics of anything. It's just sad that we don't do more
as a
city. And we could. We could.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
something that I would like to see is have that crane down by Building 6 in Heritage Park repaired, you know, refurbished, put back into working order. And a couple times a year, have a crew from the city go over there, lower the crane, lift something off a truck, swing the crane around and lower it again, then pick it up, swing it around and put it back on the truck. Just to demonstrate this used to be used here. Tell about the railroad tracks. Used to be 2 in front of the building. One was right up in front of it. When you see those big windows, those were doors originally. Mm-hmm. And there was a train track going there and they could load supplies directly into the building, which was a grain warehouse. And the equipment is still up in the rafters.
When I was a little boy, my father took me down to the railroad station. We were able to get on a passenger car and we'll go to Adams. And we got off mm-hmm. at Adams. We did a little thing there, and we came back. And I thought that was just wonderful.
Yeah.
Because in those days, it was a steam engine. They didn't have a diesel running at the time. But there's so much that North Adams has to offer in terms of the history. Now I have a bone to pick with you.
All right.
We were talking about Adams mm-hmm. and the statue of...
Susan B. Anthony.
No.
I
knew you'd bring Susan.
McKinley.
McKinley. And you mentioned that his hand was pointed toward the library.
No.
It is not.
No. I said that he's holding out his left hand like this.
Yes.
And there's a reason for that. In his day, when you were addressing Congress, you held your right hand out to say that I hold the floor. His left hand is out because he was right-handed, and he held his script in his uh-huh. right hand. In those days, nobody memorized anything, and speeches were ordinarily 2 hours or longer, so everybody held a script.
But if you see the statue, his hand is pointing down Park Street, which
yes.
was the main street in Adams.
Yeah.
Anyhow, I digress. Mr. Marino, you have the floor.
Oh,
and the table and a couple of
thank
books.
Thank you. I've always wanted a nice floor like this. I'll take it home with me. Well, last week, by the way, folks, my surgery has been postponed. So it will be at least August before I know if my A1C is down enough so that I can have my operation. So you're stuck with me until then. So last week...
I guess I'll do the show by myself.
Yeah, I'm afraid so. Yeah. Last week I
That's
promised
scary.
That I would bring you a local history book written for children, and it is this, Stories from Our Hills by Jean Jarvie. She was a teacher at Brayton School, this was written in the 1920s, and it is crafted for children, but there's still a lot of good history in here. It has a poem in it written by Washington Gladden, who was a Congregational minister who actually lived here in North Adams for a while during the Civil War. And he saw the arrival of Sampson's Chinese.
Mm-hmm.
So it has the story of Greylock, information about the Mohawk Indians, the Mohawk Trail, Fort Massachusetts, the siege of Fort Massachusetts, Ephraim Williams, the Battle of Bennington, beginnings in North Adams, and the Hoosick Tunnel. It was republished by the North Adams Historical Society, and this is something you can get in their shop.
Oh, really?
In fact, now I'm going to give you this copy because, as it happens, I do have an extra copy
Wonderful.
At home.
Wonderful. I will treasure it.
So don't say I never gave you anything besides a few arguments and
a
migraine or two. So,
this is what makes things happen here.
Yes,
we don't
indeed.
Always agree, and that's fine. It would be terrible if we did. I'd
yes,
have to
indeed.
Be put away.
Okay, so let's see here.
Don't dirty my book now.
I shall try not to. Just how this happened, we do not know. All right, and then the sea rolled away, and what had been the bottom of the ocean was piled up into mountains. Just how this happened, we do not know, but in some way the crust of the earth was pushed up from the east into wrinkles. And that's true. At one time, the Berkshire Hills, which are very old, were as high as the Rockies.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been eroding down ever since.
Paul, can I interrupt you for a second?
Of course.
When we were kids, we used to find chunks of what we call volcanic glass. I don't know what the heck it is. But it wasn't man-made.
Mm-hmm.
And they're all different beautiful colors. And sometimes if you go looking in wood, you know, in areas where there is not gravel but larger stones, you might find some of this stuff. It's really beautiful.
Yeah, there may have been volcanoes in this area at one time, but not for millions of years,
right,
I would
right.
say.
But I don't know where this stuff came from, so it's just...
Although it's also interesting to point out that this is an area that is rich in minerals, mm-hmm. so to speak. We used to have a gold mine here in North Adams.
Good mention.
We had an iron company with two mines. The problem is that they do not exist in rich enough deposits to keep a business going for a very long time. So you might find gold somewhere, and good for you, a one-man operation could probably flourish. But the iron mines paid out long before the market for iron gave up. The gold mine is all flooded now, and I expect it shut down because the gold ran out.
Now, in the very, very early times, this area was covered with water.
Oh, yes.
Hence, the deposits of limestone.
If we look at this picture here, which you can't see very well, it'd be better if we had the robotic on this, but this is showing Lake Bascom, which used to be covering Williamstown, North Adams, and Adams.
Mm-hmm.
And Mount Greylock was not exactly an island in it, but if the western summit had existed then, it would have occupied a beachfront. And this was a post-glacial lake. And when the ice dam to the west melted, the Hoosic River, which the path of which had been laid down before the ice age, carried that water out. And then when ice dams to the north melted, it carried the water through this area again.
Okay.
And that's why Williamstown has such good farmland, because of all the silts brought in by those. Now, we have about 11 minutes left. So this is a very good book to read. Even if you're an adult, I highly suggest getting this book. Oh, she's trying to use the robotic. Okay, great. So, thank you, Nicole. That's wonderful. Get a hold of this from the Historical Society. This is great for adults. It's excellent for children. I'm always trying to get children to hear local history, because they're the ones who need to hear it. It's interesting to adults, but it's essential for children so they can learn about their area and how it fits into the bigger pictures of national and world history. And as Ms. Jarvie says in the book, this is the basis of patriotism, that you learn to be happy where you are. Even if you end up somewhere else, you start with loving the place you are and with knowing about its history, and that makes you proud to be an American. Here you go, sir.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Now, this is another book you've probably seen at the library if you've gone looking for it. I got this at a book sale. My copy came from the South Norwalk Public Library.
There you go.
This is titled The Berkshire Hills. It was written and assembled by the Civilian Conservation Corps. Of course, they funded all manner of things, including a writer's project where they sent people around to the various areas, and writers went all through the Berkshires collecting local history and folklore and putting them together into a book. Now, it's a very interesting book to read, but you need to be careful about what you believe in it. For instance, in telling about the Hoosic Tunnel, they mention a man named Helton Swayze, who worked for Professor Mowbray, who of course came to North Adams to manufacture nitroglycerin for use in the tunnel. And according to the story, Helton Swayze was planning to go to a Christmas party up in Florida. And just as he was getting ready to leave and pick up his girlfriend, an order came in for a load of nitro to be delivered to the East Camp. And they quote Professor Mowbray as saying, "You better not tell your young lady what's in the back of the wagon." And off they went up the mountain. Now, Helton, known as Hel for short, H-E-L, was known as a mild-mannered man except when he drank. And then his nickname, Hel, became much more apparent. So they went in to the party, and he had a few warming drinks, got considerably warmed up, and the rough and tumble miners started razzing him, knowing they could get a rise out of him, and he started swearing at them, and then started throwing punches, and then started throwing things. And about the same time he ran out of things to throw, he remembered he had a whole wagon load of little cans, just the right size for throwing. Oh, so boy. He went out and grabbed an armful and came back in and started throwing them, cleared the place out and nothing flat. And they sent word down the mountain to Mowbray that Hel was blowing up the place. And Mowbray came up to find that Helton had passed out and was asleep among the slowly thawing cans of nitroglycerin. There are still people around who believe that story today, but there's not a word of truth in it. For one thing, Mowbray would never have approved of one of his men taking someone along on a delivery, especially not a young lady. He came here believing that nitroglycerin, oh dear God, was most stable at 90 degrees Fahrenheit. And one winter, his first winter here, there was an order for a load of nitro to be delivered to the Hoosic Tunnel Dam, where there was an ice jam and they had to break it up. And in his book on nitroglycerin, he mentions a civil engineer named C.W. Granger, or W.C., I've seen it both ways, who took the nitroglycerin, which did not come packed in little cans just the right size for throwing. It came in big cubicle cans, which when full weighed 50 pounds. So those cans of carefully warmed nitroglycerin were put in the sleigh, not a wagon, because it was winter, put in a sleigh, packed in sawdust, which had been warmed to 90 degrees, and then wrapped in blankets that had been warmed to 90 degrees, and off he went up the mountain. As he was going down the other side, the sleigh skidded and flipped over, which was actually a common accident with sleighs. Well, he dived for his life, but the nitro did not go off. Instead, he found it was frozen solid. And rather than say, "The hell with this," he righted the sleigh, reloaded it, and continued on his way. And when they got to the Hoosic Tunnel Dam, it wouldn't detonate. They had to pour hot water onto it until it thawed at least to a slush before they could get it to explode. And after that, it was always frozen at the factory before being shipped anywhere.
How about that?
Yes, indeed.
Now, so, who is the gentleman buried up at Hillside that we talked about at one point?
Oh, that was, Oh, drat, I can't think of his name. Now I have to remember it. I can't remember it.
I know what you're saying. But his story was interesting.
Yeah, but he was a... he was a blacksmith at the West Shaft, and one day there was a fire, and he was running toward the building to rescue anyone who might be trapped inside when the building exploded, and it threw a piece of wood through his jugular vein and killed him. And but the other hero of the day was someone who went and hid behind a shed. And behind a shed, how can that make him a hero? He was holding 2 50-pound cans of nitroglycerin, and before running toward the burning building, the blacksmith said to him, "You better go hide behind that shed over there," which he did, and thus prevented the accident from becoming a million times worse.
And we also have a gentleman up there who invented something to do with the railway system.
Oh, yes. That was Mr. Hodges, who invented a railroad brake.
Right.
And I would give worlds to know how close in design it was to the Westinghouse brake. Because Westinghouse is known for inventing the modern railroad brake. But of course, Mr. Hodges, or rather Hodge, Nehemiah Hodge, invented a railroad brake that could be operated from one central place in the train. And every railroad he spoke to was very interested, as long as they didn't have to pay for it.
Right.
And he spent the rest of his life trying to market it. And then finally, after his death, his son took his patents to New York City and sold them to George Westinghouse.
We do have some interesting history here.
Yes, we do.
Honestly,
we have some fascinating history.
And you know, we find a lot of it up there.
Oh, yes.
In the work that we've been doing. By the way, someone mentioned to me that we're doing some bad things up there because we have not asked the relatives of the folks buried up there whether or not we should fix their stones.
Oh, my goodness, good luck finding them.
Exactly. I asked locally, if you want to take a stone that had, mm-hmm. let's say it's fallen over, and you want to reset it on its base, it's a $350 charge. Mm-hmm. We've done 1,400 of them at no cost to them. But find the person.
That reminds me, we have about just over 30 seconds. So I want to ask you a quick question, which you don't have to answer now, but I won't even bother asking it. I'll save it for another show, or at least after the show. So we have just about 20 seconds remaining. So thank you, Roger, for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kataly, for postponing my surgery. Nicole, thank you for directing.
Thank you, Nicole.
We love you very much.
Terrific
we
job.
We love you, too, for joining us. And be sure to join us again next week for another scintillating episode. Have a great day.
Interesting show.
Now, the